வந்தே செம்புமுமாபதிம் சுரகுரும் வந்தே ஜகத்காரணம் வந்தே பன்னகபூஷணம் சிசிதரம் வந்தே பசூனாம் பதிம் வந்தே சூர்யசிஷாங்க வன்னிநயனம் வந்தே முகுந்தப்ரியம் வந்தே பக்தஜன ஆஸ்ரயஞ்ச வரதம் வந்தே பக்தஜன ஆஸ்ரயஞ்ச வரதம் வந்தே சிவம் சங்கரம். எஸ்ட்ரீம்டு ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ், எஸ்டர்டே வி வர் டிஸ்கஸிங் த வேஸ் டு கண்ட்ரோல் த மைண்ட். த ஈஸியஸ்ட் வே, த பெஸ்ட் வே ஈஸ் to observe the mind, your own mind. Mind is never quiet. It is never still. It is always engaged in thinking. Some thought or other comes to the mind. It springs up in the mind. It wanders about for some time and it disappears in the mind. Another thought comes, another thought wanders, another thought disappears. This is the nature of mind. Technically, people speak chittam, அஹங்காரா எட்ஸெட்ரா. மனோபுத்தி அஹங்கார சித்தானி நாஹம். மனஸ் இஸ் கம்போஸ்டு ஆஃப் தாட்ஸ் அண்ட் தி தாட்ஸ் ஹாவ் தி பேஸ் ஈகோ அஹம் அண்ட் தே அக்வயர் செவரல் கலர்ஸ் டிபெண்டிங் அப்பான் அவர் ஃபீலிங்ஸ். Manas is the general name of the mind. You have the samudram. Samudram is blue. Samudram is salty. And the samudram has the waves. Waves are the sea. Blue color is the sea. Salt is also the sea. Water is the sea. The whole thing is called mind. Similarly, we have our egoism, ahankaram. We have our selfishness, self-centeredness, and the thought waves. Everything is one. And Krishna asks Arjun, if you want peace, if you want to be tranquil, serene, you control the mind. Arjun says, sorry, my dear Krishna, it is very difficult. And Krishna says, I do agree, it is difficult, but it is not impossible. What are the ways then to control the mind? Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha grihyate. There are only two tools to control the mind, to silence the mind, to make the mind peaceful, to make the mind cool, or even to make the mind absent. What are they? Number one is practice. Practice of what? Abhyasa. Abhyasa means practice. And that practice is nothing but observe, observe, observe. For example, you find a cobra. You have a torchlight. you focus that light on the face of the cobra, it remains steady. It does not move about. It does not bite. It will remain silent. It will be quiet. What is the reason for the cobra to be calm, quiet? The cobra-like mind is steady, calm, cool when you look at it, when you observe it. Sit, close your eyes, welcome the thoughts, first thought. When you just observe that thought, look at that thought, gaze at that thought, stare at that thought, focus at that thought, thought will not come. The more alert you are, the more focusing you are, the more observing you are, the more steady you are, the more the mind is quiet. Observation. It's very, very simple. You can be looking at your own thoughts. Just as a thief does not enter the house when there is a light, thoughts do not enter the mind which is enlightened. Here you have the brightness of the light. There you have the enlightenment of the wisdom. When that wisdom is focused, the thoughts do not come. Ramana Maharshi, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, and all the great souls of this country have practiced that observation of the mind. It nullifies the mind. It removes the mind. It annihilates the mind. It erases the mind. Mind is totally absent. In the sleep, sound sleep, in Sushupti, mind is totally absent. Therefore, we feel fresh next day. What is it that gives you energy? What is it that gives you restfulness? What is it that gives you calmness? No activity of the body and no activity of the mind. In sound sleep, mind is free from all activity. What is the activity of the mind? Thinking. When that thinking is absent, it rests. When it rests, it is refreshing. During the daytime, when we are awake, when we are engaged in physical activities, we can make the mind still, calm, tranquil. And that state is called Sthita Prajna. Sri Krishna is without worry, without hurry, without tension, without anxiety, without any problem, because his mind is calm. As a person's mind in sleep is. The only difference is we are wakeful. The other person, while he is asleep, his mind is quiet. Is it possible to keep the mind calm while being wakeful? Yes, very much. You look at Buddha's face, peaceful. You look at the small baby's face, cheerful. You look at a great yogi's face, very, very calm. This is possible by controlling the mind. You are stress-free. It is very easy. Yesterday I tried to narrate the story of a thief and a police officer. The platform, the railway platform is infested with the thief. He is robbing the people, cutting the pockets. Everybody was worried. Everybody was thought stressed. Everybody was anxiety ridden. And the complaints went. A special police officer came. He had his seat on a particular place, at a particular place. He was looking at the thief. Thief was looking at the police officer. They were engaged at looking at each other. The cobra is looking at the focus, light. Light is looking at the face. They are engaged, quiet. When they both are silent, you are free. Thief is unable to commit the theft because the police officer is observing. Police officer is waiting for the thief to commit the theft. He was unable to commit the theft as long as the police officer was looking. What is the net result? Mind is quiet. Mind is calm. After some time, the thief left the mind because the police officer is alert. The platform, railway platform, is free from the thief. When the thief has gone away, when the thoughts have gone away, the vigilant observer also need not be present. He will also go away. Both of them are absent. The cobra is absent, the focusing torchlight is absent, and the garden is peaceful. The mind is calm. Yogis attain the highest by just observing. This is number one method. Observe the mind with vigilance, with alertness. Look at the thoughts which are trying to rob your mind. When you very keenly, carefully, concentratedly look at the thoughts, thoughts won't come. By practice, the vigilance also gets reduced. The smallest example, you are walking in a bush. There is a thorn pricking your foot. You take another thorn from the same bush. With the new thorn, pinning thorn, you remove the prickly thorn. When the pricking thorn is removed, the helpful thorn is also not necessary. Both the thorns you throw away, your skin is soft, safe. Similarly, the mind is pricked by a thought. The mind is disturbed by a thought. And you make two parts of the mind. One is the thoughtful mind. The other is vigilant mind. When the vigilance is very serious and sincere, the thoughtful mind withdraws no thoughts. When the thoughts are not there, the vigilance also is not there. The mind, the platform, the railway station, everything is quiet. And in that state, we remain peacefully. So the sum total of the argument so far is observe, observe, observe. Second, now we go to Vyasa Maharshi, who is followed by Vivekananda Maharshi, and Vivekananda makes another method, gives us another method to obtain the same calmness. What is that? The mind is never quiet. It is mischievous. It moves about. And what is the area of the mind's operation? Time. Time is like a tree. The tree is full of branches. Branches above, branches below, branches in the center, middle part. Mind is like a monkey. It is fickle. It is wandering. It is moving. It is never steady. It is never to settle down at any particular place. Without any reason, it will be moving. You try to observe a monkey. You try to observe a dog. You try to observe a mind. You try to observe a child. The child will be moving. Why? He himself does not know. Dog, why does it run from this side to that side? It is its nature. Same is the case with mind. It is its nature to move about. Same is the nature with the mind. It is its nature to move about. First step. Where does it move? Where does it operate? In time. That time, let us take it as a tree. The monkey is seated in the middle of the tree, in the central branch, let us say. It will not stay there, it will go up. When it goes up, it is nothing but future. Mind goes to the future, or mind goes to the past, or mind goes to the sideways in the present. There are only three: past, present, and future. Lower branches, central branches, and the upper branches. It may go to the lower branch or an upper branch, or in the center when it is seated, it will go to the right or left or front or back. This is its nature and area of operation. Now Vivekananda says, look at that mind. It goes to the future. It climbs up. What mind goes up? Young mind. Youthful mind. You try to take 100 young boys or 100 young girls and ask them the questions. They never think of the past. They are bubbling with enthusiasm. I shall be the collector. I shall love that girl. I am fond of this boy. I shall do this. I shall do that. They are always in the future. The nature of the young mind is to go to the future. And in the future, there are two: the broken branch, dry branch, falling branch, fading branch. The other one, bright branch, strong branch, flowery branch. Vivekananda says, don't allow the mind to go up. Control it. No, sir, it is not listening to me. It's not obedient to me. It is flying to the future. Every young boy flies in the future. And then it is said, okay, if you are unable to restrict it, contain it, stop it, allow it to go to the bright side of the future, not the darker side. Let us observe our own minds. It goes to tomorrow. It goes to day after tomorrow. It goes to next year. It goes to 10 years later. Mind is never quiet. And when it goes to the brighter side, it is a dream, rosy dream. It is a reverie, daydream. When it goes to the dry branches, dull branches, it is gloominess. It is a fear. The other one, hope. This side, it is a despair. Hope is in the future. Despair is in the future. Faith is in the future. Fear is in the future. Mind is never in the present. It goes to the future. First of all, to make it calm, allow it not to go to the future. Control it. No, sir, I am unable to control. Then change its direction. Let it not go to the negative side. Let it go to the positive side. Once I was in Hyderabad, the Ramakrishna Math, there I spoke. After the talk, I came to the road and I was waiting for my son to bring the vehicle so that I can board the car and go home. Somebody told, there is curfew. The curfew is because there is some problem. Vehicular traffic is stopped and the sun may come to the other side. I have to go to the other side. I should cross the road. The ambulance may come. The traffic police may come. The fire engine may come. I may, while crossing, fall under the wheels of the vehicle. My legs and hands may be broken. My identity card may be lost. I may be rushed to the hospital. I may not be in a position to tell them my address. And there, the treatment may not be properly given. I may die a tragic death without any identity, without anybody coming to rescue me. This is the imagination. Where am I now? On the roadside, standing on the pavement, waiting for my son. At that point of time, I am safe. There is no motorbike, there is no accident, there is no hospital, nothing. All this is imagination. Imagination is in the future. Dream is in the future. Hope is in the future. Fear is in the future. Faith is in the future. Who goes to the future? Mind. And my mind has gone to the future. In the future, there are two, positive and negative. My mind has gone to the negative side, that I may die, that I may be in the hospital, that there may be an accident, that I will be losing the identity card. All this is a negative imagination about the future. Vivekananda says, why do you allow the mind to take a wrong direction, negative direction? You use that steering to the positive direction. Curfew, no doubt. And curfew is because the Congress President Sonia Gandhi is coming there. I am standing on the pavement. Now my mind is thinking positively. Few minutes more, the pilots will come. Next, Sonia Gandhi will come. She will look at me standing on the roadside. She will ask the driver to come to a stop. The car comes to a screeching halt. She will get out of the car, open the door and come walk towards me. She will look at me. Sir, you here in Hyderabad standing. What a surprise, sir. Once upon a time, when Rajiv Gandhi was alive, when he was the Prime Minister, you were visiting Delhi frequently. I was serving you food on the dining table. You were responsible for starting autonomous colleges in the country. You were responsible for introducing value education in the schools and colleges. You were responsible for changing the Ministry of Education into Ministry of Human Resource. You did so many good things. You were an excellent advisor. You were always helping in the ministry. Now we are out of power, sir. We want to come back to the power, sir. Please come, sir. Sit down, sir. Let us go to the circuit house, sir. Let us plan for the revival, sir, etc., etc. She will say, I will go to the circuit house, and then she will give me excellent lunch. After that, we will have an excellent discussion. This is how I was dreaming. Now, you listeners, viewers think, what a foolish imagination. Will it come true? No. It may not come true. Do I die under the car? Will it come true? No. Hopes may be liars. Fears are dupes. What is the guarantee that fear of the future will come true? What is the guarantee the hopes of the future will come true? Hopes may not become reality. Fears also may not become reality. Both are reveries, daydreams. Both are dreams. Both are imagination. They both are your fancy. Your mind is going to the future. Vivekananda says, anyhow, you are unable to control the mind. You are unable to stop its movement. Mentation cannot be resisted. It goes to the future. What is to be done? You turn the direction. Don't allow it to be negative. Promote its progressive path. What is it you get? You will be happy. In all the cinemas, what do the lovers do? There is a dream sequence. The boy looks at the girl in the park. The girl looks at the boy in the classroom. She goes back, he goes back, and they sit relaxed. They close their eyes, and there is a beautiful dream sequence. Boy and girl will go to heaven. They have wonderful costumes. They fly in the clouds. It is happiness. It is exultant merriment. They enjoy the dream. If it is negative, it weakens the mind. It makes the mind dull. You will become negative. The first step is take the rod, be firm, be a controller of the mind. If you are unable to be a firm person to control the mind, allow it to go, but to the positive future. Let it not go to the dry branches which may break and you may fall. Let it go to the sturdy branches of fruit and flower so that you can eat, enjoy, and stay there strong. This is an addition. Vivekananda's contribution. Let us be positive. When we are unable to control the mind to a cessation, to total stop, allow the mind to go to the future, positively dreaming, you will be enjoying. Two, lower branches. Many people of my age don't have future. They don't think of a future. They go to the past. Youth, young boys and girls go to the future. Actually, age is determined by the movement of the mind. At the age of 80, you can be a young boy of 20 with all enthusiasm flying to the future. I am 80. I never feel sorry. I am never negative in my imagination. I am bubbling with enthusiasm. I have activity after activity to be performed in future, and I am always young. The youth of a person is decided not by the physical features. It is by the thoughts. One Swami Chidbhavanandaji Maharaj, at the ripe old age of 78, he started an institution. How bold, how strong he is. At the age of 118, a gentleman saved the idol of Meenakshi Devi in Madurai from being stolen by the Muslims. At the age of 100 or above, Ramanujacharya was very enthusiastic to receive the mantra from his guru. There is no age to the mind. Mind can be made dynamic, young, energetic, enthusiastic. It depends upon the positive nature. Not only the young boys and girls, even at the ripe old age, you can be young and charming mentally. I live in the future. I have 100 projects to be performed. I have 100 ideas positively worked out for the welfare of mankind. And Vivekananda's ideal way of thinking is direct the mind to the bright positive future, never the negative. The other side, going back, reverse side, I am a frequent traveler. Earlier, before the menace of corona, once I came from Hyderabad to Bangalore by train. The train stopped on platform number 6. I got out. I alighted. On platform number 5, there was another train. Just then it too came. From both the trains, nearly 2,000 people, 1,000 from each of the trains alighted, and it was a small platform. On one side of the platform, there is a foot over bridge. Everybody has to climb up, come out of the railway station, and return to their respective places. 2,000 people were climbing the narrow foot over bridge. I am a little old physically. I have a shoulder bag and a briefcase. I was climbing up with one hand on the railing, and ahead there was a beautiful girl, lightning-like girl, an 18-year, 19-year-old girl, beautiful girl going. And behind me there was a road Romeo, a rowdy, about 20, 25 years. He was chasing her. He was following her. He was running behind her. And the bridge, it was overcrowded. The steps were overcrowded. The man came behind me. He placed his left hand on my right shoulder, pushed me to the side, and went ahead. Before going up, he looked at me and shouted, "You old idiot!" He went away. I looked at him. I looked at that girl, my young boy. Some 60 years ago, I was also like you. The boy went. Slowly I climbed up, went out, and from my house, from my ashram, two disciples came. They brought the car, AC car. They opened the door. They garlanded me. They touched my feet. They offered pranams. They took me home to the ashram. Now, about 2 months ago in Bangalore railway station, in the morning at about 7 o'clock, two incidents happened. Number one fellow put the hand on my right shoulder and pushed and said, "You old idiot." The other, outside the railway station, the car was brought. I was garlanded. My feet were touched with all respect. I was comfortably taken home. What do I remember? Better don't remember both. Past is past. Forget about it. That is control over the mind. But mind is sensitive. I am unable to forget. I am remembering. Then what is it that you remember? A weak man, a sensitive man will remember, he called me idiot, he called me idiot, he called me idiot. Is it not psychic weakness? Then Vivekananda comes and tells, "A fool, why do you remember the negative past? Same day, same railway station, two young disciples came. They offered pranams. They garlanded you and they touched your feet. Why don't you think of that and be happy? Why do you remember the other idiot? He called you an idiot, fact. These people worshipped you as your master, fact. There are two facts in the past. Better you forget them both, live in the present. But when you are unable to forget, when you are unable to control the mind, direct the mind to the positive side. Ravana, in the Ramayana, had many people who fell in love with him. Only Sita rejected him. She defied. Now, Ravana remembers whom? He remembers Sita. That girl did not look at me. That girl did not love me. That girl rejected me. Why should he think only of Sita? Why can't he think of the very many beautiful girls that fell in love with him? It is human weakness. It is a psychic weakness. The first psychic weakness is to go to the past. Bury yourself in the past. Almost all the retired people bury themselves in the past. You go to an old man in the house. When I was the tahsildar, when I was the principal, they don't have future. But a yogi neither goes to the future nor goes to the past, but is steady in the present. Vivekananda says, arrest the mind. Patanjali says, chitta vritti nirodaha, take a stick. Keep the mind silent. Allow it not to go to the future. Allow it not to go to the past. Keep it steady as the cobra is focused. It cannot move about. It will remain as it is. Keep the mind steady at the feet of the Almighty. Keep the mind steady looking at the face of the Almighty. Sri Raghavam, Dasharathatmajam, Aprameyam, Sitapatim, Raghukulanvaya Ratnadeepam, Ajanubahum, Aravinda Dalayataksham, Ramam, Nishachara Vinashakaram, Namami. Keep that Ram, lotus eyes, beautiful nose, tall personality, majestic, magnetic, smiling, benevolent, magnanimous, generous, cordial, coming, close to me, hugging me, kissing me on the head. Can't I look at that mighty personality, Sri God? Are the pleasant thing, we are unable to pin the mind to the present. It goes to the future. Doesn't matter. It goes to the negative future. And that causes stress. That causes fear. That causes tension. That causes worry. It goes to the past. Doesn't matter even if it goes to the past. Everybody in the past had very many good things. When I was in the LKG, my principal lifted me, held me in her arms, gave me a gift, kissed me. Can't I remember that? I remember only my failures. I remember only my disappointments. It's foolish. So Vivekananda's approach is, if you are unable to arrest the mind, keep it steady. At least give a positive direction. Many people know Mata Amrutanandamayi. She is a very positive lady, divine lady, hugging Devata. Her ashram is there in Kerala. Now and then I go there to take classes to the brahmacharis and brahmacharinis. Once I was in their ashram. I was walking with Mata Amrutanandamayi in the corridor. There was a young brahmachari sitting sorrowfully, leaning against the pillar. Ma Amrutanandamayi looked at him. My boy, what's wrong with you? The boy came, touched her feet. Amma, that man scolded me. Amma asked him, what did he say, my boy? He called me a dog. You dirty dog, he called me. Then Amma said, do you know him? No. Does he know you? No. Do you love him? No. Does he love you? No. What he said, is it true? He called you a dog. Are you a dog? Do you have four legs? No. Do you have a tail? No. You are not a dog. Now she analyzed. You do not love him, he does not love you. You do not know him, he does not know you. And what he said was in the past, and that too an untrue statement. You are not a dog. Why are you worried? Do you know me? Amma, I know you. Do I know you? Amma, amma, you know me very, very well. Do you love me? I love you so much, Amma. Do I love you? Yes, you love me so much. Do I hug you? Yes, with all affection you hug me. Do I kiss you? Yes, you kiss here on the top of my head and you suck like anything and you remove all ignorance. I feel heaven in the embrace of a Devata Mata. My boy, while kissing you, while hugging you, what do I say? My God, my jewel, my gold, my muttu, my manikyam, my marakatam, my gomedhikam, na bangaram. I say so many good, beautiful, loving, affectionate words. You have forgotten them all? It was yesterday. It happened this morning, but that fellow called you dog day before yesterday. That past unhappiness is haunting you. You are brooding over that past. You are unable to remember me. It is your psychic weakness. Every individual has a happy past. Every individual has an unhappy past. Every individual has a bright future. Maybe he will have an unhappy future. Mind is yours. Mind is your servant. Why can't you think positively of the future? Why can't you think positively of the past? Stay. Enjoy the bright future mentally. Stay, enjoy the bright past mentally. Just think, this is Vivekananda's way of regulating the mind. The third is, neither future nor the past, we are in the center, present. While staying in the present, The mind won't keep quiet. It wanders about. That is our students in the classroom. The teacher is teaching. The lesson is in progress. You are seated comfortably after the breakfast. You don't have any work. You are seated with the purpose of listening to the teacher present. But the mind is not there. Once in Bangalore, in our university, I was taking a class at 9 o'clock. It is called Maitri Milan, a friendly meet. There were ladies, there were men. Among the ladies, there was a lady of about 30 years, 29, 28 or 30. Very beautiful lady, very young lady, very attractive lady, very fascinating lady. While taking the lesson, I was looking at all the faces and I was concentrating in my subject. I was delivering the talk. Suddenly, that lady developed certain fits. Her hands were getting stiffened, and the eyes were becoming red. There were tears flowing. She was very much frenzied. She was under the clutches of fear. These people sitting by her side were frightened. One person came and tried to bring a little water to be sprinkled on her face. Another person ran to bring the stretcher. Another person went to bring the doctor. The lesson was stopped. I went to the lady and asked, "What's wrong with you?" 9 o'clock, I started the lesson. This happened at about 9:10, 10 minutes. That lady closely looked at me. "Sir, tell me, I am coming from Hyderabad, sir." "Very good. My mother and father have gone to Kashi for yatra, sir." "Good. What's your problem?" "My mother-in-law and father-in-law have gone to Rameshwaram." "Yes, that's good. What is your problem?" "I have a son and a daughter. The boy is 6 years, the daughter is 8 years. They both are studying in a school." "Very good. What is your problem?" "My husband is very tall, very handsome. He looks like a cinema actor, very powerful personality." "Yes, what is your problem?" "At about 8:45, the school bus comes and takes my son and daughter to the school." "So what? What is your problem?" "Mother and father are not at home. Mother-in-law and father-in-law are not at home. My children might have gone to the school at 8:45. Now it is 9:15. The servant maid, who is very beautiful, wearing a window jacket, comes exactly at 9 o'clock. My husband is a software engineer. Now it is a difficult period. Very often these software engineers work from home. My husband, very tall, very attractive, very handsome. He looks like a cinema actor. This girl servant maid comes at 9. It is 9:20 now. I don't know what is happening at home, sir." Even if something happens 700 kilometers away, what can she do? She is in a beautiful place, excellent university, wonderful hall, pleasant climate, some lecture is going on, you have come to study here, you are away from them all, you are unable to put your mind in the lesson. That is what is happening to our student community. They are in the classes, but minds are not there. They wander about, either positively or negatively. This lady is a negative woman. Why should she imagine something is happening at this time? mind is a weak instrument. It goes to the negative future. It goes to the negative past. It goes to the negative sideways. Instead, Vivekananda says, positive movement of the mind is better. You will be enjoying it. This lady could have imagined, first of all, going away from the place of activity is bad. If it is unavoidable, let her remember Sri Ramachandra Prabhu at home. This is puja time. My husband is at home. He is preparing to go home, go to the office. He is in the puja room. Sri Ramachandra Prabhu comes and gives darshan to my husband. She can as well imagine that. So everything is in our mind. First of all, observe it and keep it steady. That is Vedantic. That is Patanjali's. That is yogic. Keep the mind still. By simply observing it, it cannot move about. It is bound, it is steady, it looks at you. Second is, you don't have enough strength to control it. It goes to the future or past or sideways. Let it go. You try to have it positively progressing. This is the second way. So Sri Krishna in Bhagavad Gita says, Abhyasena tu Kaunteya, you the son of Kunti Devi Kaunteya. Practice. Practice what? Observation. Alertness. And keeping it positively moving. Either this or that. You can use a firm hand. You can use a cajoling hand. In either case, it is your mind. My hand should listen to me. I ask my hand to go up and it goes. My mind, it is my slave. It is my assistant. It is my servant. Should I dictate terms to my mind or the mind should dictate terms to me? I should not allow the mind to be my master. I am the master of my mind. It should be obedient to me. It is my dog. It's my monkey. It's my money. It's my body. It's my mind. It should be my slave, my servant. That is Rajyoga. You elevate to be progressively positive. Give a little freedom to it. This is the second way. And then Sri Krishna says, Vairagyena cha grihyate. Vairagya is not hatred. Raga, dvesha. Dvesha is dislike. Raga is like. Viraga means without any attachment. Without raga to it. We have many likes. For example, I like one dish, maybe rasgulla, or gulab jamun, or some other food dish. I am dreaming of it. I am invited to a house. The housewife knows my likes. And she is bringing that favorite dish of mine to my plate. Looking at the dish, my tongue waters. There is saliva. If there is a meter to measure the enjoyment that my mouth has, it will be showing 200 out of 100 meter will be going round and round when I take the first bit. And gluttonously, avariciously, with the utmost desire, I am just swallowing it. And if there is a meter, There are meters to measure your blood pressure, meters to measure your sugar levels, meters to measure your temperature, meters to measure your oxygen level. Similarly, if there is a meter to measure your pleasure, it will show 150 or 200. First dish of my liking, maybe gulab jam or rasgulla. Looking at me, she will bring the second. If you take the measurement, 1 or 2 points less it will be. The pleasure level will come down. I come to the 10th dish. It comes to 70. 15th piece, it comes to 20. She brings the 50th piece. I put it in the mouth. It comes to zero. Pleasure level is zero. She will bring the next one. Now it begins the minus, repulsion. Not hatred. I don't have any more attraction. I don't have any more liking. The pleasure level is receding, coming down. And she says, sir, one more. No more. Why? If I take one more, what I have taken so far will come out. I will vomit it, and that is vairagya. Everywhere, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam, punarapi janani, jathare sayanam, iha samsare, khalu dustare, krupayapare, pahi murare. Same life, marriage, children, money, status, fame. And Adi Shankara beautifully says, Nari sthanabhara nabhi desham, drushtva maga moha vesham, yetan mamsa vashadi vikaram. What is there, my boy? Marrying, earning, eating, meeting, dying. All this is one experience. Same experience again and again and again and again. Punarapi jananam. When you feel the same thing repeated, wherever you go, the same rasgulla. Wherever you go, the same life. Alexander asked one yogi of India to come to Greece. He said, is there anything different there? No. There also people walk on feet. There also women beget children. There also people breathe in oxygen. There is nothing new. When you find the staleness of things, you will develop viraga. Repetition, repetition, repetition of the same. And then mind withdraws from that repetition, from that mechanical life, and it becomes steady. An adept driver, he drives the car mechanically, his mind is at his disposal. Similarly, vairagya helps us a lot. Practice helps us a lot to control the mind, to silence the mind, to steady the mind, to make the mind quiet. I have taken sufficient time. Let us practice. Let us develop detachment. Let us try to withdraw. Let us try to develop that vairagya. Sri Krishna's classic statement in Bhagavad Gita. It's not impossible, my Arjun, to be free from the clutches of mind. Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha grihyate. Let us be detached, let us be withdrawn, because there is nothing new in this world. Everything is the same stale repetition. Adi Shankara nari sthanabhara nabhi desham. It's all the same. It is all the same world. Let us grow to be wise. Let us grow to be enlightened. Let us thereby silence the mind. When we silence, we enjoy the sweetness, we enjoy the calmness, we enjoy that silence, we enjoy that bliss. Anandam brahmeti vijanat. May we all, by the grace of God Almighty, remove that mind, annihilate that mind, transcend that mind, go beyond that mind, to be absorbed in that enlightened state. Hari Om Tat Sat. Thank you very much. Tomorrow we shall take one more chapter, and that will be the last. Hari Om.